I'm excited about episode 2 of Puck Culture. Welcome to the show, because the Grim Reaper is in the house for this edition. And Stu, for anyone at home that's listening that doesn't know this, you and I have worked a lot together over the last, two plus years?
A lot.
Like, to the point.
Well, we're in our third year. This is my third year at the network. And
me too. We started at the same time. Yeah, we did. Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, the funny part is, as time evolves, I feel like I'm doing more and more NHL now for whatever reason. Yeah. Maybe that's a question for the producers here. Why are you sticking me with Jackie and EJ so much?
Well, you got a problem?
No, I mean, it's like, I feel bad. I feel bad for you. Mix it around.
No,
it's good.
It's good. Get some
other talking heads in there.
It is.
But we're on a lot together.
We are. But we have a three-day rule.
Yeah.
We know this. Yeah, we talk about it all the time, that we do 3 days and then we part ways.
And we're violating the rule today, because we've worked Monday, Tuesday.
Yes.
Leading up to today, Wednesday. We're doing a podcast together right now,
yeah,
as we're speaking. This is a podcast, and then we'll do NHL Now later today. That's 4 times in 3 days. That's a violation of, it's not so much my rule, it's your rule.
It's my rule, but it's not a day violation. There's no show cap.
I guess
it's just
so.
3 days in a row, so. And then you got to switch it up, you know, keep it fresh for the people. But this is Puck Culture. If you're listening for the first time, we talk all things hockey, but we also incorporate a little bit of entertainment. We talk to celebrities. We're going to have Nicholle Anderson on the show a little bit later. She is a Hockey Fights Cancer ambassador. She was the official ambassador a couple of years ago. She's the wife of Craig Anderson.
And wife to a goaltender. I got some stuff.
Oh,
for
I know.
You I got always, some stuff for her. I want to probe the inside
got,
of the mind
yeah.
of the goaltender's wife. I want to get inside her mind.
Yeah, exactly. And you've always got intriguing questions. So you can listen for that in a little bit. But I mean, the Islanders, Stu, win their 10th in a row last night. We cannot record this podcast without going there. I mean, they are the real deal. It's crazy watching this team.
Yeah, it's amazing. I'm baffled by it, because, you know, I shouldn't say I'm baffled by it. I think it's one of the great, wonderful surprises of the 1920 season so far, is that the Islanders kind of continue under this progression of really dramatic improvement under Barry Trotz. And I go back to, like, I've known Barry since I was 16 years of age. We grew up in the same organization, the Regina Pats organization. So I've been around him for all my life. And the other interesting thing is, when his teams first broke into the league, when he first started coaching the Predators, Barry Trotz, and this was a different era of expansion, Jackie. Like, this wasn't the Vegas Knights expansion.
Yeah,
it was a lower.
That's the new school.
It was a lower talent base. But the one thing we always said, and I played against his teams as a member of the LA Kings, as a member of the Anaheim Ducks, I played against Barry Trotz Predator teams. And they weren't the most talented group out there, but the one identifiable characteristic they had, they were in every game that they played. They worked hard every night. They played within that really strong defensive structure. And that's going back to, you know, the late 90s.
Yeah.
And when you take that kind of discipline and you apply it to a somewhat more talented roster like the New York Islanders, or go back a little further, like the Washington Capitals, and you see the results he's had, I guess it's not surprising, but it's a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah, he's a heck of a coach, clearly. But what I'm enjoying about this streak the most is Islanders fans, because they are such a vocal group of fans. I mean, last year it was all about Tavares left us, we're still upset, we're going to chant at him during the game. I mean, it was a storyline the whole year, even though the Islanders, you know, we're doing better without John Tavares than they were with him in the lineup the previous season. But now this year, it's we're the best team in New York sports right now. Pay attention to us. I think every day on NHL Now, I get a tweet from at least a handful of Islanders fans. They're saying, you didn't talk about us till the B block. Like, talk about us. I think it's amazing. I love hearing from Islanders fans, because they're so passionate.
Well,
and they're finally getting that national attention that they've longed for a long time.
Well,
so.
Remember this, too. This is a very proud organization. You go back to when I was a young boy. I grew up watching the Islanders rattle off cup after cup after cup.
Yeah.
4 in a row, if I'm not mistaken. And I got to play with guys like John Tinelli towards the end of his career, near the start of my career, you know, guys that are legendary. Got to know Bobby Nystrom through Eric Nystrom, his son. So it was a real coup for me. But the amazing part about that is, like, you go back into Islanders folklore, they've had really some amazing teams. Hockey has been ingrained in that part of the country. So to see this resurgent, I mean, they just rattled off, was it 13 wins in a row? Last night was their 13th?
No, 10th. 10th.
Sorry, 10th win in a row. You go back to some of the glory years to find another streak like that. So I love it for Islanders fans. You know, I continue to believe they're some of the proudest, some of the most vocal. And you put them inside Nassau Coliseum. If you've ever seen a building there or seen a game in that building, it's older, it's dark, it's kind of dank. It's not the biggest barn. Everything feels like it's right on top of you. But that makes for a really, really cool, it makes for a really cool atmosphere. Who did we have on the other day? We had Josh Bailey on our show the other day, and they've gotten into now, every time Josh Bailey scores a goal at home, they're doing, oh, baby.
The hey, baby.
They're doing that. And it sounds like it sounds like British rules soccer in there.
Baby.
It sounds like,
you know,
Western
crazy?
Europe soccer.
So we talked to Josh about that the other day, and I didn't know the origin of how this started, and a passionate Islanders fan informed me on Twitter yesterday after watching the interview. They said, you know, that actually started as a bad thing. It started, you know, sort of as a joke because Josh Bailey wasn't scoring. And so it was almost like they were trolling him. And then he became this lovable character on the Islanders. And he started coming up clutch in playoff games and different scenarios. And then it became a positive. It's like, but how it actually started was actually us kind of giving him the gears a little bit.
Yeah,
like, would you please give us a goal when he was in a rut, right? So it started out as something maybe not the greatest, but at least now it's turned into something positive for everybody there. And I just get an absolute kick out of Islanders fans. I actually think they're like low-key hilarious. I just think they're funny. They're just like paying attention to me. They're like your younger sibling that just wants
the attention so bad. You feel like they're low-key after Tavares came back for the first time last year? Do you remember how vocal they were?
Yeah.
The signs that we saw.
Oh, my gosh. They were so vicious.
I mean, they completely went off on John Tavares, which was interesting.
I'm glad that that's in the past now. You don't hear as much about it now.
It's an indication of just how rabid that fan base is. And it's fun. I mean, it's exciting. As long as it stays within the bounds of safety and good taste, I'm all for it.
Hopefully they don't give me flack for this, but they're a little bit of a thirsty fan base because they're in New York where, you know, the Yankees dominate and football dominates sometimes. And even when we're talking hockey, you know, the Rangers dominate most of the time. So they're finally getting their glory. I'm happy for Islanders fans.
Fun team to watch. Oh, my gosh, they're a fun team to watch. Yeah, they're talented.
It's been an interesting week, though, elsewhere. We go from Tavares' former team in the New York Islanders to his current team, the Toronto Maple Leafs. And I got so fired up about this on Twitter the other day when Drew Doughty was asked about the comments Ovi made about what the Leafs need to do to be successful. And I held the opinion when Ovi made his comments that, you know, you have to play differently, you have to be more defensive when you get to the playoffs, you have to block shots, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
I defended Ovi. I said, he knows. He went through it all. He went through the pressure. He went through being called a player that will never win and all of that stuff. So it made sense. And then when Doughty was asked about it, he responded very generally, talking about what any team needs to do to win a Stanley Cup. But the way that it was presented to the public by more than one publication or outlet was that he was giving his thoughts on how the Leafs need to play differently.
Yeah.
And I didn't think it was fair before he responded to the comments. But then I got even more upset when he did respond to the way that it was published, because he is a very rare individual in the NHL in that he is always honest and he is always candid. Yeah. And Stu, we are in jeopardy of losing honesty from Doughty. Before we dive into it, let's just, for the people at home, listen to Drew Doughty's response to how everything played out in the media with his comments. Here's what he had to say.
Oh, I wasn't talking about them necessarily. The guy asked me, you know, Ovechkin commented about something about how teams need to play differently when it gets to playoffs, so I wasn't commenting on Toronto at all. I was just commenting on winning the Stanley Cup in general. If you guys want us to, like, be able to say things and be honest with you, and then you're going to go run with it and, you know, just get attacked by it, we're just going to stop talking, so that's it. Like, yesterday, I didn't even know I said anything bad, and then here we go again. It's like, I don't even know what to say.
So the part of that jumped out to me, Stu, was him saying, I didn't even know I said anything bad.
Yeah.
As a former player, sort of your opinion or reaction on how this all played out? Because I, for one, I felt bad for Drew Doughty.
Yeah. And as a former player, I was always one who was really cautious about anything that I said, because I've been fried by the media before as well. They can take a very small thing, they can amplify it, they can use it against you. And ours is a culture where, you know, we don't really say anything or do anything to kind of humiliate or cast our opponent in a bad light. It'll come back to bite you.
There's a bit of a code there, right, within the respect of the players.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so we're seeing the Tkachuk versus Doughty. We're seeing that kind of thing. But that's pretty isolated. It doesn't happen a lot. These guys just go at it hard, and they're not shy to kind of talk about it. But really, where a team or your opponent more generally is concerned, ours is one where you just kind of, you respect what they got going on. Don't speak into their space. Don't try to put them in a bad light, because it'll come back to bite you. The game, you hear me say this often, Jackie, the game will humble you. But, you know, ours is a sport now, and all sports are like this, where they're growing in popularity. And with social media and the innovation of the internet, there are so many different outlets out there competing to have the next sexy, sensational headline. It's just become
to get the clicks,
and it's just become fever pitch. So now when somebody says something like Doughty did and Ovi was the same way, I agree with you. These were really generalized comments about what it takes to win in a broader context, not leveled at the Leafs necessarily. Yes, said in front of Toronto media, but it's not, you know, an indictment of the Leafs. So to go off on these guys and to sensationalize and amplify what they're saying and kind of spin what they're saying and have it come back against them. I mean, I'm with you and I'm with Doughty. Be careful how you do this, because it's not far away that we'll be operating in a world where all of these guys will close us down, and they won't allow us to peek behind the curtain.
It's sort of this hypocritical thing, right, where we're constantly like, oh, hockey players are boring. We want them to have more personality. We want to know what these guys are like off the ice. What are they like behind the scenes? But then any time, or most of the time, when they do say something they really think, or they do sort of, you know, break the mold and show you who they really are, they get flack for it. That's a tough spot to put an athlete in, especially when they're facing the media day in and day out. And, you know, Toronto and we'll put Montreal in there too. They are the hotbeds of hockey culture, right? Like, that is where there's the most pressure. The fan bases are passionate, and more than that, outside of hockey, they are the number one sport in those cities. They're not competing with the baseball team, with anything else. So it's a high pressure market in both Toronto and Montreal. Do you believe that there is a section of players in the NHL that don't care to play in a market like that because of the media and the risk that comes with it?
I think if you polled the players, if you polled 700 plus players across the NHL and, you know, given a choice between two teams, the money is the same and the opportunity to win is the same, would you go to a market like Toronto versus a market like, just, I'll pick Nashville because it's close to home for me.
Right.
It actually is home for me. I think you'd find the overwhelming majority of players say, I'd prefer to go somewhere where the media speculation spotlight, it burns just a little less brightly.
I think it takes a certain type of individual to thrive in that type of environment. I mean, you look at Phil Kessel's years in Toronto, right? They were very tumultuous. That could not have been easy for someone like that to go every day and have to deal with the ridicule, then the love, then the ridicule, then the love.
I have said for years and years, you know, for a market like Toronto, Montreal is very similar just in terms of how fever pitch hockey is there, just how close the scrutiny is. It's a really hard market for a young player to develop, and especially a goaltender, because the scrutiny can be intense. And really, heading into that market, if you've signed up for that as a young player, I'll tell you what, you gotta find a way to tune it out. Don't listen to it as you drive to the rink in the morning. Don't read a paper the next day. Just stay off your phone and stay out of it.
Well, you know, Darcy Tucker was asked about this whole situation on Toronto radio a couple of days ago, and he talked about in his days, right, when he played for the Leafs, they were making the playoffs every year. Yeah. But there was criticism and scrutiny that came with that team as well. And his whole thing or piece of advice to anybody that's ever plays for the Leafs was, you got to change the narrative, because you're never going to control what they write about you. All you can do is control what you do on the ice and the things that come out of your mouth.
You know,
but it's I have heard numerous superstar level players over my short time in sports, less than a decade, say they would never want to play in Toronto.
This is kind of to your point, but this is one area where I give Mike Babcock, the coach of the Maple Leafs, a lot of credit, because I remember early in his tenure, I was in kind of a broader seminar, it was a media seminar, and he was one of the speakers. It was early in his tenure as the head coach of the Leafs, and he addressed this very point with his players, how hard it is to play there. And the message was really simple. When you're great, when you're good, don't be afraid to take ownership of that. You know, don't be afraid to, this is what we did right, and deflect some of the attention to your other teammates. But when you fail or when you make a mistake, you got to take ownership of that too, where the media is concerned. So there's good times, there's bad. Be a professional, own up to it in either case. But beyond that, just kind of move on. And I think that, you know,
easier said than done, though.
It really is.
I mean, when I
no
think
question about
it,
but that's a dynamic you really have to address in that market, as opposed to maybe 15 or so of the other markets across the NHL. It's just a different dynamic. And I lived there for 2 years when I worked as in-house counsel for the union. And nobody loves their Leafs more than Leafs fans when the team's going well, but nobody loves to hate the Leafs more than Leafs fans when it's going bad.
They're passionate.
It's cannibalistic in some respects. So it's an interesting market. It really is.
It's funny because I remember one of my first experiences in hockey, I would go to the Leafs games, and I was a microphone holder, right? Like I would just hold the mic before the game. Yeah. Hold the mic after the game, get the sound. I was way too terrified to ask any questions because I was, you know, first job in sports. I was terrified, really, if I'm being honest. And I'll never forget one day waiting for the camera guy to sort of pack up all the equipment. I was outside the dressing room. He was kind of getting all his stuff together. And a West Coast team was in Toronto that day. And the morning skates had just happened. And a couple of superstar level players on this team, I won't name them, but they were having a conversation with some friends and family that were there to watch the game.
Yeah.
And, their friends were saying, like, how do you do this every day? Like, every day. Where we play, there's like one camera and a handful of writers. Like, this is not what we deal with.
Yeah.
And both guys were telling their friends and family, like, I would never want to play here. I couldn't do it. I couldn't deal with the pressure and the media attention that you get every day. They were talking about how they like to, you know, outside the rink, go for dinner, go do their thing, and not necessarily have to hear about the mistake they made the night before on one shift of the game that cost, you know, no goal, let alone a goal.
Yeah.
So I've heard it more and more as I, you know, get more experience in covering the game, but it's interesting.
My personal experience as a player, so I, you know, playing the role that I did, a physical role, I honestly, it's not that
you would have garnered no attention for the role you played.
No attention whatsoever. No attention whatsoever. And when I played for the Blackhawks, Toronto was in our division, so we were locking horns, you know, several times a year. But we would go into Toronto, and I play that physical role. And it's not that I would, you know, I would say there's no chance that I'm going to get into it with anybody. But if I, my point is, Jackie, if I could avoid it, because I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to kind of put myself necessarily in that stage in front of, really, it's the mecca of the hockey world. This is the epicenter, the nervous center, and I would avoid it if I could. So
which is crazy to think about. You're like, you were avoiding doing the thing, very thing you were there to do.
I sure wasn't going out of my way to get into it necessarily.
Yeah.
And maybe there's a different mindset from one player to another. One might kind of engage because you're going into that market and you want to make a splash in that market. But I'll tell you what, there's a lot of us that go into that market, into Toronto as a visitor. And at least in the early going, you're squeezing the stick a little bit tighter because, you know, I mean, show up for morning skate. There are dozens of media outlets there to greet you, as opposed to being in Raleigh, North Carolina, when they first started, and there's a beat writer from the paper, and there's your local radio guy.
Yeah,
you know,
and that's it.
There's two guys show up, and they have microphones.
Yeah, and, you know, for a veteran like Drew Doughty to sort of bring it full circle, it's not like that was his first time facing the media.
No.
He knows. Drew Doughty knows when he says something that is going to get attention. Like, when he talks about Matthew Tkachuk, he knows he's stirring the pot and something's going to happen. He's been around long enough. So for him to say, I didn't even know I said anything wrong, tells you sort of the level that it's at. But I honestly, even with the Doughty stuff, I think we're going to see more of it. I think Toronto media will continue to ask superstar players about
the leaks. I was going to make this point, too, because in the broader context, if you think about it, and this isn't just on the media, this is in us as consumers of news, as consumers of sports information, as consumers of, you know, celebrity gossip.
Politics.
We all live, politics especially, we live in a gotcha society now, because we see how prominent these little hits become over time. Everybody with a camera out there is potentially the next news source, and we all love to read these little gotcha moments. But I think as a society, there's a lesson to take from all this. Let's just be careful how we position, you know, the next so-called, you know, sensationalistic news story or sports story, because everybody's capable of making a mistake. Nobody's perfect, and you've got to kind of look at the bigger picture. That's hard to do in our society today.
Oh, yeah.
We're different. We've changed that way.
Context is important. I think that's the lesson.
You made a really good
point.
Figure
out the context of the comments before you react
to
them.
And Doughty's comments were made in a general, not Leaf-specific context.
Yeah.
And he's expressing his disdain for the media in the comments that we listened to
exactly.
earlier.
I'll tell you what, I'm glad I'm not a beat writer that needs to get those types of comments every day. I just go and try to have fun and talk about, you know, people's pets and all that non-serious stuff. That way nobody can get mad at me, at least.
We don't do gotcha at NHL Network.
We don't. We just talk about the game that we love. But someone that, you know, is no stranger to the Leafs fan base and the passion that comes with that city is Nicholle Anderson. Yeah. She's going to join us next. She is the wife of goaltender Craig Anderson, who of course plays for the Ottawa Senators. That Battle of Ontario has been very real at times over the last couple of decades. So she's no stranger to that. She is also an ambassador for Hockey Fights Cancer. She was the official ambassador for Hockey Fights Cancer a couple of years ago. She joins us now. Nicholle, thanks for doing the show. We appreciate the time. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
We are fantastic. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. We're going to talk Hockey Fights Cancer. I know you're very involved with that again this year, but we wanted to just have a little fun off the top. Where are you calling us from right now?
I am calling from South Florida.
Oh,
What takes you to South Florida? Vacation?
No, actually, this is where me and Craig met. When he played for the Panthers, I lived here. I was teaching school, and my only contract with Craig through this whole journey is, when it's all over, we live in Florida.
Okay.
Amazing.
No knock on the fine folks in Ottawa, Ontario, but if I had my
weather's
choice.
Weather's a little different.
Yeah.
Weather's a little different.
Probably a different planet, really, when you contrast the two. I'd end up in South Florida, too. Sweet spot.
But you know what? If I could bring anything from Ottawa to Florida, it's the people in the community. Like, Canadian people are just beautiful, they're nice, and the whole community is awesome in Ottawa.
Yeah.
What grade did you teach?
Oh, I taught fourth grade.
Oh, my. So how old are kids when they're in fourth grade?
Like 8, 9.
Oh, okay.
8, 9 years old.
That's a fun age.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. They're still innocent, and they want to learn. They love their teacher a little bit still, so it's good.
Right.
Will you go back to teaching in the after-hockey life, Nicholle, or are your Hockey Fights Cancer responsibilities just that's your new focus? That's your important emphasis now.
Well, if I could do it all, I would love to in the perfect world.
Yeah.
But absolutely, right now, I'm still substituting. So I have a job next week subbing for another teacher down here. I love kids. I love to teach. But that brings my passion over to Hockey Fights Cancer. It's bigger, and it's like I'm so much knowledge from that. Like, I feel like I can't walk away from helping the cancer world either.
Oh, you are a sweet soul.
You know what? You just sound like you've got so much going on. Like, how awesome is it to have a husband who also has a lot going on, to be so supportive of you sort of having your own thing, doing your own thing on the side? I mean, the fact that you still teach, I love that.
Craig understood from the get-go, I'm a very independent person, and even though we're apart, like a little bit with this last year of his contract on the contract, I've always been independent, so I like to do my own thing, and I love hockey, and don't get me wrong, I love going to the games, I lived it like almost every day because I left teaching a little bit to go to Colorado and to go to Ottawa. But I always struggled missing my own thing. And he knows how important it is to complete myself. So, like, he understands.
Do you think that,
his life.
Do you think that's, like, a common sort of thing that women who are dating or married to professional athletes sort of go through? Just that way to find the balance of being supportive but also, you know, having your own thing?
No, I have watched a bunch of the girls in the league do their own thing, and it's amazing to see because you could get trapped in this world where you go to the hockey game, you take care of them, and you miss yourself. And I admire, there's so many women in the league that have their own blogs, or some of them even like work full time and do 100 different things. So I think it's very important
That
everybody has their own thing.
Nicholle, we thank you. We applaud you for your role in the Hockey Fights Cancer space and the ambassador that you have been. But I talk to people all the time who kind of step into a cause like this, and their ambitions are to do some good. But the amazing part is they come away almost, you know, absorbing or taking a gift themselves. Has that been your experience? What has your journey taught you? What has your journey showed you? What amazing people and stories have you kind of experienced over your few years in that role?
I think going through cancer and walking into that office and being diagnosed and not knowing what, quote, radiation really is or chemo really is, even though I taught, it was a whole different world I didn't know. And to have a platform like this to give back and be able to educate other people, like people think cancer, okay, you're over it, and there's so much more that goes on after it, that if I can give back, help, even raise money for a little cause to help even, like, we're doing a Hockey Fights Cancer fundraiser with two other girls in the league to give back to the Hope Lodge. It's meaningful impact. And if I'm able to do that, it's more rewarding for me to be able to give back because I've been there. So, like, there's so many people who don't know so much that if I can give them a piece to even help their day, make them smile, or even sit there and have a conversation with them, I don't know. It's just very self-rewarding to help.
Yeah, well, and listen, observing from a distance, we know the impact that you've made. But listen, if we, in our time with you, if we can, I'd love to pivot more to the personal side. And I want to share with you, I get the sense, just the interviews I've seen and being around your husband, he kind of breaks the rule. He's not one of our quirky kind of offbeat goaltenders, but I hope you're going to tell me different. Are you able to kind of share what's life like living with a goaltender? As an ex-player, I am fascinated by the species of person.
Well, I will say this. Do I think goalies are their own breed? Absolutely.
Yeah.
I never was into hockey until I dated Craig and went to my first hockey game. He literally thought I lived under a rock. And I was like, I don't watch hockey, but I'll go. And during the last 10 years and watching goalies, they are different. I feel like Craig is an introverted person. So yeah. He's more quiet. He's a racing guru. Like, he's into racing. So, like, I know some of them like to golf and do his thing, but he finds avenues outside the game that he, like, dives into, and it keeps his mind off of that daily grind, I want to say.
Yeah. What kind of racing does he like? Is it like Formula One? Is it NASCAR? Like, what do you know? Do you know what kind of racing he follows?
So if it was up to Craig, and I'm not up on all the lingo of racing, because to me, the oil, the track, it just does not smell nice to me.
Fair enough.
I would say, like, he likes all that novice racing in the summer, like where they go to the campsites and they all do novice racing. I know that Travis and Trevor up at the Calabogie track in Ottawa, like, he has united with them. But he likes Formula One. I'll be honest with you, if there's any race on the TV, he'll watch it. Like, for his birthday, I surprised him with going to, oh my goodness, the Indy 500. And that was my first race. So, what? Like, I think he just likes the excitement of all of it. And his dad used to race cars. So it's like a very Anderson.
Okay, there's where it comes from. I got it. That's
incredible.
Okay, that's cool. I didn't know that about him. So he's a racing fan. It's you make a good point, though, because a lot, you know, you think hockey players, it's like a lot of them like to golf, and it's a lot of the same sort of stuff. So cool to hear something a little bit.
Golfing for him makes him cringe. He's like, I hate the golf.
Yes, honesty.
A good walk spoiled. I'm with him. A good walk spoiled. That's golf.
Nicholle, earlier in this show, we were kind of talking about, you know, the media responsibility that comes along with being a professional athlete, and I'm sure you've dealt with it too in doing your stuff with Hockey Fights Cancer. And I don't know if you saw the story about Drew Doughty sort of having his comments twisted the other day, but just as somebody that, you know, is close to someone in the game that is and has experienced the market that is Toronto and the Battle of Ontario between the Leafs and the Sens, just sort of your take on the pressure that comes along with you know, playing the position of a goaltender and then the media, you know, coverage that comes with it.
Well, this question just makes me, like, laugh inside, actually. well, I look at it like this. After all of it, like, the media has a job to do, and it's to sell the game in a way.
Right.
But also, when a goalie wins, a goalie shines in the media. When the goalie loses, the whole game is blamed on the goalie. And that's the way, like, your perception of the world sees it all. Like, a goalie can make 20 to 30, like, saves a night, but there could be five scoring chances that are, like, six saves. But because you let one of them in, you're terrible, but it shouldn't even have been a breakaway 2-on-1. But the media has to cue in on that bad thing, but no one watched the whole game.
Yeah.
So, like, I have to remove myself from that because yeah. I love a lot of the media guys, too, because I know them. So they're doing their job, and I don't know. I think it's a vicious cycle with
no,
the media.
No, that makes sense.
Spoken like a true goaltender's wife, the
it's,
advocate
you know,
for the goaltender.
She makes a good point,
no,
though,
no,
because
absolutely,
like, when
absolutely.
A goaltender has a good night, if someone yeah. on their team scores two goals and has an assist, yeah. that's what people are going to write about, which I understand. But it would be difficult to sort of – deal with that
yeah.
on a night-to-night basis.
Well, and Nicholle makes another interesting point, too. You know, you can't just look at the raw statistics, you know, the quality of chances and shots that a goaltender faces on any given night. That can dictate how successful
yeah.
or not successful that person is. So you live with the peaks and the valleys.
Yeah, 100%.
Right. So I personally, sometimes I just have to, like, I don't read the comments on Twitter or
yeah.
anything
yeah.
because I'm like, these people don't understand.
Yeah, social media is a whole other can yeah. of worms, that for sure. But, you know, we had Carl Subban on NHL Network last year, and he talked about his three boys, one of which is a goaltender. And he said he's the hardest kid to watch because he's like, I can't
yeah.
handle it. It's
yeah.
like I'm too – he's the one that he worries about the most when he's watching the games is his goaltender son. So.
And that's a good point. Like, my in-laws, they told me growing up, we sat across the rink. He's like, I could not listen to the people around
yeah.
me and different
yeah.
things. And, yeah, it's a different position. I'm trying to brainwash my kids. Like, you don't
want to
be a goalie.
Don't be a goalie.
You don't want to be a goaltender.
Be a
that's so funny. I love it.
I'm not a lifer. Your mom is not a lifer.
Oh, Nicholle, you're such a pleasure. Thank you for taking some time to chat with us. Good luck with all of your Hockey Fights Cancer initiatives. And for anybody listening, you can go find Nicholle Anderson. You're on Twitter, I would imagine, so people can find out how they can help, how they can contribute.
Yes.
All right, perfect. You can find Nicholle Anderson on Twitter. Thanks,
thanks
a lot, Nicholle.
Thanks, Nicholle. We enjoyed our time with you. Thank you.
You too.
Man, Nicholle's so cool. Like, she just strikes me as a cool chick.
Great. I like she gave us a little background on Craig and the way he operates, too.
Yeah, she was totally open to the combo.
Anti-golf, but loves racing. There's a goaltender I played with when I was early in my career, Eddie Belfour. He was a complete
Eddie the Eagle.
He was a complete muscle car freak. He worked on his own cars. He had this whole fleet of muscle cars.
I'll tell you what,
he's
Ed Belfour, like, fascinating.
Oh, he's
obviously
out there.
And I think, like, I would love to have Ed Belfour on this show
yeah.
to just pick his brain about who he is.
He'd love to
come on.
He's actually
you got the hookups too?
I think we can get him on.
Yes.
He's created his own line of alcohol. It's like a flavored,
shocking.
You know, cocktail.
No, I'm just kidding.
Okay. All right.
I'm just joking. It's a cocktail. I might have to check it out.
Yeah.
All right. We were kind of riffing on the whole Doughty, the media, all of that stuff earlier. So I threw out to Twitter. I wanted to know what other people were fired up about because I think it's important to incorporate our audience into the show. So I'm going to just wing it here, open up my Twitter account, and fire some of these at you, okay?
Okay.
Okay. The first one is from David. He says, Bad Boys 3 looks good.
Right on point.
Bad Boys 3. There you go.
Who's in Bad Boys 3? Does that give you any idea?
I actually don't know. I assume the cast is returning, some of the main cast. All right.
I'll watch the trailer after we sign off.
Chris Hines says the Avs have been playing terrible. Their efforts have been brutal. This is not a Landeskog Rantanen thing.
It's not a Landeskog Rantanen thing.
Yeah, it's not the injuries. It's the effort.
Oh, I don't know. If you go back to a time when Landeskog and Rantanen, I mean, here's the thing. You take two important pieces like that out of the lineup, everybody all of a sudden is sitting in a different chair, the wrong seat on the bus, we like to say in hockey parlance, and it takes a while to adjust to that. I think the Avs will improve as time wears on, but there's no question. Once those two guys get back in the mix, that's a maturing, improving team. They're
I'll tell you what, though,
right
those
direction.
Injuries were well-timed for the Dallas Stars, just saying. Yeah. Call Me Jake says, Leaf fans that don't act like Leaf fans, I've cheered for them 62 years, and I hate Leafs Twitter. Yes, Jake, I am with you. All Leafs fans, I grew up a Leafs fan, all Leafs fans get painted with the same brush. It's BS. Yeah. We're not all the same.
Yeah, there's a lot of them out there.
There is the stereotypical Leafs fan, and that there actually are some of us that aren't as loud. I know I'm loud, but I'm not loud.
I will say it's a good point. Most of the people I know in my, you know, my social circle who are diehard Leafs fans, you know, they of course love them in good times and they're disappointed in bad times. But there's this, which is different from this whole sector of other fans out there having lived in that market. I mean, it gets nasty, especially on social media.
Let me tell you something, though.
When the Leafs are off their game, it gets nasty.
It does. But I will say, now that I've been in the United States for a couple of years covering hockey, there are other fan bases that are... There's sensitive fan bases. There are overreactionary. There are other fan bases that have their own flaws. I mean, come on. Okay, Dennis says Canada-Russia series.
72?
I was like, what?
Summit
series? What year are we talking about right
72?
Now?
We're going back to 72 with that?
Oh, my gosh.
Well, it was 70s night at Vancouver last night. Okay. And you and I dressed up for it.
Oh yeah, we were dressed 70s.
We were dressed up for it.
Oh, here's what I love about when Stu Grimson's on NHL now. Stu Grimson takes the best pictures for the gram. Like you have become my Instagram guy.
It's the hype girl. I can hit the high shots, I can hit the low shots. I got an angle that a lot of your other
cohorts
minion analysts don't have.
Fair enough. All right, I'm going to give you one more. This one's from Jeff Adams. He wants to know between Buffalo. Well, first of all, he rhymed off like a how much wood could a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood, which I'm very good at. Don't even test me on it.
All right.
But his actual question was between Buffalo, Arizona, Florida, Vancouver, and Edmonton, which teams do you see making the playoffs of that group? So it's Buffalo, Arizona, Florida, Vancouver. I have my answer. Can I give my answer?
Of them, and you can take
you
as
can take
many
more
as
than
you
one.
Want.
Yep.
And, okay, go ahead.
I think the Vancouver Canucks are making the playoffs for sure. And you know what? I think Arizona can make the playoffs too.
Yeah, Arizona's the only one I'm a wee bit suspicious about. I don't
really?
Know if they get the offensive support. I don't know if they sustain
You're
it
not worried
for an
about 82 Edmonton?
Game schedule. No, I think Edmonton, really, they're top six. I worry about the way they defend, and they seem to get pretty decent goaltending.
Ooh.
I don't know. Edmonton's just off on too hot a start. I think it's, you know, barring injuries, for me, I don't know. I continue to be strong on Edmonton.
Ah, really? I am not that strong on Edmonton. Yeah. I mean, listen, McDavid and Draisaitl are insane, and James Neal has obviously added to the mix, and Mike Smith, you know, is providing some goaltending, which they've needed for a long time. But I just don't know if they have enough depth. But maybe they do. I guess we'll find out.
They got something special going on there, and it's been a long time coming.
I disagree, but I guess time will tell. Let's get to our last segment of the show. We do this on every show, Stu. Here's how it works. Every week, our player analyst is going to try to one-up the story of the last player analyst.
Okay.
So last week, Scott Hartnell, Hartsy, told us a story about being on the set of This Is 40. He met what is her name? Super hot. Megan Fox.
Megan
I was going to be like, super hot. Who is that girl? Megan Fox, yada, yada, yada. So the floor is yours to try to one-up.
Did he have a speaking part in that movie?
I think he had one line.
One line?
Yeah.
And how many words were in that line?
He said it was like a 60-second scene. It was like short.
Is he the guy that loses his teeth?
No,
and somebody swallows
no.
The teeth?
That was his teammate. Was it Toffoli, maybe? I can't remember who it was, but
yeah,
teammate at the time.
I think I got one to match that. Early in my career, I played with the Chicago Blackhawks in the early 90s. And if you remember, SCTV was really big, like Second City Television down in Chicago. John Candy he'd been rattling off all those John Hughes films.
The legendary, you know, John Candy.
The legendary John Candy.
No, well, you're longer, already winning because
no
John Candy, Megan
us.
Fox. I mean, what does the scale look
so
like?
So we had this, I forget what the name of the charity was. It'll come back to me. Oh, it was the Women of Maryville, or it was some team kind of oriented function. We got to know him working at these different charity functions. He would always come out to them. But the relationship evolved to a point where, like, John Candy lived downtown Chicago. Of course, being a Canadian, he loved hockey. He'd come out and see us as often, you know, as his schedule permitted. And we'd often, you know, be out at a
All right,
bar
let's
in Division Street
get
downtown.
Get to the goods.
And
have
John
you ever
Candy's
done
hanging
shots
out with, us.
With John Candy?
No, I never did shots with John Candy. I never did that. I wish I could tell you that, but I never did a shot with John Candy.
But you didn't. But you hung out with him.
We had beers.
Okay, well, that's better.
It was like, yeah.
I mean, that's cool. You say it so casually.
Such
like,
a nice
oh, I just,
guy.
I hung out with John Candy, one
as
of the most famous
star,
Canadian comedians of all time.
As big a star as he was, you know, you get him in a social circle like that, and he was
what
just.
What was he like?
He's just really, I wouldn't say soft spoken, because he's a really jovial, you know, loves to laugh. Laugh the entire time you're with him, but a really warm hearted guy. He was just a lot of fun to be around.
Oh, really?
Oh, he was fantastic.
Oh, that's
fantastic
awesome,
guy.
How much did he talk hockey when he was with
oh,
you?
Oh, he loved to talk hockey. Absolutely. That's all he wanted to talk about.
Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, we're probing him for, you know, SCTV
celebrity
and
stuff.
Celebrity stories,
yeah.
And he's probing us for hockey stories. But we used to get a lot of celebrities out back in Chicago in those days. Of course, Vince Vaughn comes around a lot now, but Jim Belushi used to come around a lot.
Oh, that's
well.
Cool.
Yeah, it was great.
That's cool.
It was a lot of fun. Him and Candy were real good buddies.
Okay, I like that. I like that. That's a good story. I think I'll give the edge to you.
Okay.
I'll give the, because, you know,
I'm trying
I don't
to,
think people call Megan Fox a legend. No disrespect to Megan Fox. It's
well,
just
here's
different.
The thing. I'm trying to, like, I'm here this week one-upping Scott from last week, and I understand next week as
You're
I'm back.
Back
again, I'm kind of managing my one-upmanship because I got to speak to this next week. So I'm, you know, this is called one-up management. What I'm doing now.
Okay.
I'm positioning my stories.
All right.
So
well, you know,
I don't want to blow the lid off. I don't want to blow the lid off the place right at this point.
No, that's smart. You're being strategic about it, which I respect.
I suppose.
This has been fun. It's been fun talking to you.
Have you enjoyed it?
I have. I actually really
I've enjoyed
have.
It. Yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully everyone at home enjoyed it.
Do it all
too.
Again in a couple hours.
Yeah, you're going to be back. Well, we're going to be on the network later, but we're also going to be back next week for the next
week.
Episode
I'm
of
looking
Pop
forward
Culture.
To it. It'll be great.
As well, if you have any questions or thoughts for Stu, he will be back next week.
Yeah.
So hit us up on Twitter. With the hashtag Puck Culture, and we'll see if we can get some of the people's questions.
And don't necessarily make the questions about the game
they can
you
be about
see
anything.
On the ice. Let's talk about the culture of hockey. Like, what's going on in the room or
Maybe we should,
in and
next
around
week,
the game?
Next week, I think we should get into sort of the whole, like, dressing room code. I've always been fascinated by the
that
sort
kind
of the code of the players. But it's
Peek
been a good time.
Behind the curtain next week.
Thank you for listening to Puck Culture. We appreciate it. If you haven't picked up Stu Grimson's book as well, you can
Jackie,
also find
there
that.
You
I
go,
plug it like it's my job.
Grim Reaper book again.
He's not paying me, but yes, it's a great book. Lots of great stories in there. And if you like this podcast, there are a family of podcasts being produced by the NHL right now. One of my personal favorites, the Fantasy on Ice podcast, because I play fantasy hockey and I thoroughly enjoy it. Executive Suite is another one. If you're into sit-down interviews, you can get some fantastic stuff there as well to find out a little bit more about some of these front office executives. Thanks for listening to this edition of Puck Culture. I'm Jackie Redmond. He's Stu Grimson, or the Grim Reaper, and we'll see you next week.